Good evening, everyone.
Welcome, everybody. Welcome to episode 14.
Yeah.
14, season two of WAW, World According to Woot, where?
The show where important topics of the day are largely ignored.
And foolishness reigns supreme. I decided to take that one for you.
Oh, well, thank you.
Thank you. I took one for the team.
And we're here to ask the eternal question.
What's happening? Well, a lot is happening tonight. A lot's happening tonight. And we have a fun guest tonight.
Oh, yeah, we do. It's going to be a blast.
Yes.
It's going to be a lot of fun.
Mr. Jeffrey Bryan. Multi-talented Jeffrey Bryan.
Yes. One of the most phenomenal keyboard players you will see in any band.
And I have, to give him a little thumbs up on when he was sending me his information and all of his pictures. I have to tell you, he sent me everything in organized folders. It was the best. That's how I function. Yeah. I function in folders and little titles on everything. It was amazing.
She's used to dealing with me where everything is disorganized.
I loved every minute of it. Right. Anyway, so welcome, you guys.
Yes, welcome. Thank you for joining us tonight.
So we have some housekeeping. First of all, we have always been Wooten Wednesdays, right? Always.
Pretty much, yeah.
We are not going to be Wooten Wednesdays anymore. We are going to be, I don't even know if this works, Wooten Thursdays?
Wooten Tootin Thursdays.
I don't even know. We'll have to think of a coin phrase. Anyway, Thursdays is going to be our night.
Yes.
Because, explain, Ricky.
Yeah. Got a lot of explaining to do. No, TLR is actually going to be doing a residency at the Wealth Resort on Wednesdays. So we're kind of wanting to make the transition now. That residency is going to be between June 1st and August 30th.
Right. So Wednesdays are going to be no more Wednesdays. We are going to make WAW on Thursday night. Hey, Larry. Hey, Claire. Eric. Masha.
Hey, hi, Masha.
Masha, you have a birthday present in the mail.
Hi,
it's
Larry.
Coming.
Hi,
hey, Patty. So
thanks for joining
starting us. Next week.
And Russ. Russ is with us.
Hello, Russ. We are going to start Thursday night, starting next week.
Is that next week?
It's starting next week.
Okay.
Yeah, we're going to get you guys in. And guess what we're doing on Friday? We are jumping on a jet plane.
Yeah.
And we are heading up to go see Sir
Paul McCartney. Yeah.
At the Oakland Arena. So excited. So we're making a weekend out of it. We're going to go see Paul McCartney.
Yes.
We're leaving Friday morning at about 11:15. Going to roll into our fantastic Lakeside Hotel.
Wait, Lakeside?
This is part of Jim's birthday gift. It's the birthday that never ends. I'm telling you, this birthday, it's okay, just a nonstop birthday for
how
Jim.
How much is this actually going to cost me?
That's the question he's been asking me. And the answer I give you is, you know what? Don't worry about it. Have a good time. And I'll handle the financial part of it.
I'm sure
that's why
will.
We're in financial ruins. But you know what it's about? It's about the fun you have, not the money you spend. Is that correct?
I'm going to remind you of that when we're living in the back of my van.
All right.
Okay.
Well, we have lots of friends that may let us sleep in our places. So Paul McCartney's on the
Friday,
6th for us.
Friday night.
Yeah.
That's going to be a great time. We're really looking forward to that. And not this weekend, we're at Paul McCartney, but on the following Friday, the long run is going to be back at the Montclair Canyon. We're going to be playing, I believe, starting at 8 p.m. that night, but we're going to be playing all of your Eagles favorites.
Oh, and this is a special night. We're graduating from Jim's birthday 2 months, and we're moving to my birthday.
Is that what's happening?
Well, I feel like it is.
Really?
My birthday is on the 15th. That show is on the 13th. We're going to celebrate my birthday.
Okay.
Well, yeah, okay. It's going to be a fun night.
Yeah, well, maybe we'll mention it from the stage.
I'm all, we'll make sure.
And then the party's going to continue the very next night on the 14th, May 14th. Led Zeppelin is going to be playing at the Belly Up down in Solana Beach.
Okay.
So make sure to mark your calendars. 13th TLR at Montclair Canyon, 14th Led Zeppelin at the Belly Up in Solana Beach.
But then we have a special Father's Day thing happening, right? Something for Father's
That's
Day?
That's next month, okay. Yes.
In June.
That's right. June 19th, Father's Day. We got a very special concert doing James Taylor and Carole King, and opening with Deja Vu, a four-man acoustic opener for that night. So we're really looking forward to that one.
All right.
That's at the Canyon in Agora.
Canyon in
Canyon
Agora.
Club in Agora.
All right. All right. And we have our last, we have Calvin. We can't forget Calvin.
No, you can't forget
Calvin's
Calvin.
Auto.
Are you kidding?
I call it Auto Works, but it's not Auto Works. It's Calvin's Auto Repair at 501 East Glen Oaks Boulevard in Glendale, California. If you need a car or truck or vehicle repaired, Calvin's Auto Repair, he is your guy. He is your guy. And if you mention WAW, you get 10% off of whatever service you get. Yeah. So make sure you do like a engine rebuild or a transmission. Make it worth your money.
Yeah, that's right. You can take the family out for dinner on what you save on the 10%. Right?
Calvin's the best. So again, 501 East Glen Oaks Boulevard in Glendale, California. Calvin's Auto Repair. Mention WAW, you get 10% off. And if you go to www.theblondiecollection.com, you can get a personalized tumbler made by me. And I will make you the best tumbler you've ever had. So www.theblondiecollection.com. Go to my website. You can see tumblers I've made. And it'll be a party. They're a great gift. And you say it all the time. It's a good gift, right?
Oh, they're great gifts. Yeah. Because you can personalize them. Yep. You can put any kind of logo or name on it.
Yeah.
So it's very, very cool.
Yeah. So Claire says you guys have too much fun. We do have too much fun. I feel like, do we have too much fun? Is there such thing as too much fun? I don't know, Claire.
Yeah, I mean, I honestly, when you play in a working band, I mean, it's like the fun never stops, right?
Hey, Rick.
Hey, Ray has joined us.
Yep.
He and Val have checked in.
All right, anything
Thanks
else?
For joining us,
anything
guys.
Else? Paul McCartney,
hey,
we're starting WAW on Thursdays.
Debbie, I went to high school with Debbie.
All right, what's Debbie have to say? Montclair Canyon. We'll see you at
awesome.
Montclair Canyon.
Very cool. Baby.
Celebrating my birthday. That's going to be a birthday night for me.
That's right.
We're going to dedicate the entire night to my birthday. The entire night. That's right.
Todd says, hey, he loves Paul McCartney. You remember Rocky Raccoon? That was actually one of the first songs I learned on the guitar, Todd. Was Rocky
and I got
Raccoon.
I got us some good seats. We're front and center.
Yeah, it's going
to
be
front
awesome.
And center. We will not have somewhere to come back and live, but we'll be seeing Paul McCartney, and that's the important thing. Hey, Diane. Diane, your gift is in the mail, too. I was full of gifts today. I sent a lot of gifts out today.
You usually say I'm full of something, but they're usually not gifts.
Well, you know.
Okay, so what else do we got to talk about?
Well, I don't know. You're the promo king.
Well, why don't we go right to the promo video?
Yeah. We're going to bring our good friend Jeffrey Bryan, or as we know Jeff.
Yeah.
Jeffrey's his formal name.
You know, Jeff and I actually played together in the long run quite a few years ago. I he'll probably remember better
did,
than I.
You know that was something I didn't. Did I know that?
No, you didn't. He
he used to fill in.
He played keys and sang. And did all the, I think the Joe Walsh vocals, which is what Chris Garosi
I saw
used
that
to
in
be.
His bio that he had played with the Long Run.
Yes, yeah.
Why was I not at that show?
I don't know. Maybe you were.
I would have remembered because Jeff is a multi-talented guy. I mean, telling you right now,
yes.
he's a talented dude.
We saw him, and I don't know if the band is even active anymore, but. When we saw him play with Fool's Logic.
Oh, man.
That
was my
incredible.
First. That was my first experience. Yeah. Fool's Logic. Jeff, that was fantastic, by the way.
Jeff played an incredible piano solo on that. And after they peeled me off the floor, I went over and told him that it was absolutely phenomenal.
That was my first meeting with Jeff.
Yeah, that's right. Fool's Logic. Yeah. I think that was the first time you
met him. Yeah, he was amazing. And then I experienced him in... K-Tel All-Stars, I believe, next.
Next. Probably.
And then, of course, Robert PlantNation. But then there's so much more people.
Yes, we can't wait to dig into all this. Yeah, he's got a lot to talk about.
I've highlighted so much. So he has a lot. So we will dive into his promo video, and we will bring Jeff on and learn a little bit about Jeff.
Okay, roll the tape, Roscoe. All right.
Thanks for joining us live from Los Angeles with singer-songwriter, keyboard player Jeffrey Bryan. Taking us back to 1987, the song is Kingdom by Icehouse.
One of those days that just comes and goes is not so special. She watches the bird that rests on a ledge outside her room. Wallpaper old and faded, the crack in a window pane. Radio just keeps playing, playing that same old song. Smiles to herself that think I'm strange. They say I'm a dreamer, but I don't complain, though I don't have much.
Welcome, Jeff. We are so happy to have you on.
I'm good.
Okay, we got you.
I am unmuted now.
Now you're good. Wow.
It's great. It's great to be honest. It's great to see you guys.
Yeah.
Good to see you too.
You were a teenager, not when you were a teenager, but when I was a teenager.
Really?
So, no, we're the same age. Jim's not the same.
She's aged.
We're all teenagers here. It's okay.
I'm telling you, all that stuff is just a rush of memories.
I know.
I love it all. I love it all.
You know, speaking of memories, you touched on this. I did meet Jim. It was 2009. And okay. I did a myriad of shows with TLR.
Yes.
If I remember correctly. It's how I met you. It's how I met Smitty. Remember Smitty?
Oh, yeah. Yes.
He put Fool's Logic together a few years later. That's how I kind of got into that. I mean, yeah. TLR was sort of my entree into tribute world.
Wow.
So to speak.
It's kind of that's interesting.
My training wheels tribute band for me.
There you go.
So
you guys put up with me, but.
So you came from a pretty significant band. When you entered the tribute world, were you a little bit kind of reluctant on like how you felt about that? Did you?
Yeah, definitely. Here's the thing. You know, I mean, I know a lot of musicians and have through the years, of course, and I have a lot of friends that were in tribute bands, so it wasn't really like unusual, but for me it was, because I was, you know, pursuing more original endeavors, and but man, I just wanted to keep playing, and you know, my cover bands that I was in on the weekends wasn't really cutting it. And so I answered an ad, and I'm trying to remember, was it Chris Verosi? I think.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's right. There.
And it was his connection to me that brought me in. So I guess whoever needed a sub, was it's their responsibility to find some guy. And okay. I was that guy. And it was Gary Hagen.
Gary,
that's right.
Remember Gary? Yeah. I think he passed away a few years ago.
Well, Gary Ricciardi did.
Gary Hagen and I are still friends. I mean, he's great. And and then, you know, of course, Berto and Gig. And then there were three different bass players.
Yes.
And that's why I wasn't sure you were in the band, because you were like running out to Zip again.
Welcome to my life,
Welcome to my life. To be honest, I thought you were a Barry Gibb tribute.
I'm working on that, by the way.
I'm looking at, you know, okay, there's a Joe Walsh, there's a Glenn Frey, Barry Gibb. What is Barry Gibb doing?
I'm just having trouble finding a Robin. I mean, do you know anybody that can sing like that guy?
Yeah. You
know? You're going to be Morris, right? So if we have
Maurice would be me.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
Like, balding, and he's got like a high voice and stuff. Yeah. but he's not as short as me, so I got that.
Well, let's jump right into where were you born? And where did you grow up?
I grew up I was born in Encino.
Encino.
I grew up in the Valley. I'm a Valley boy, man. I started, my parents were all over. My dad was a salesman, so he kind of worked for different companies and shifted us around throughout Southern California. So most of my world was in the Valley. And then by high school, I settled in Woodland Hills and went to Taft.
Taft. Yeah, I know Taft. I know. I went to Kennedy, so we played you guys.
Oh, okay.
What
I never asked you where you were from. So that's, I never even thought about it. I just assumed you were California too, right?
Yeah, we're not a Hills, California. What year did you graduate?
80. I'm not telling you guys.
83. But we were Valley kids, and the Valley was probably one of the best places to grow up in the 80s.
Totally. Yeah. I agree with that.
The 80s. Yeah.
It was, you know, there was always that healthy, I don't know if it was so healthy, that sort of rivalry between Over the Hill.
Yep.
And you know, Valley people against city people, so to speak.
That's
you know, right. And of course, everybody had friends on both sides. So it was really kind of a weird rivalry. It was like, you know.
But yeah.
Anyhow, that movie Valley Girls. Remember the movie with Nicolas Cage?
Oh, Valley Girls. And I know you know this one, Fast Times at Ridgemont High.
Oh, of course.
I always told Jim, that was, if you watch the movie Fast Times, That was my high school experience.
Yeah.
Was right, it really?
Right there.
Yeah.
I mean, she didn't sleep with that guy.
No, not that.
Where are you from, Jim? I never asked you that. Are you?
I'm actually from the San Gabriel Valley.
So you're like in another country.
Yeah, yeah, pretty much.
Like
yeah.
Europe.
Isn't that true, Brenda? That's what we thought. Anyone that wasn't from LA or the Valley was in Orange County. That's another country.
Totally Egypt. We have no idea.
North Dakota, from what we cared about. Yeah.
Yeah, I grew up in El Monte, if you're familiar with that.
Yeah, sure.
But don't hold that against me, Jeff.
It's the other way around now.
Yeah, there you go.
Oh, you're from the Valley?
Yeah.
Let's start off with, so you grew up, you went to Taft. What was your first experience with even knowing you wanted to be involved with music? Was it school experience?
I've been singing and playing since I was about 11. And if you really want the real nitty gritty here, the real truth is that my parents wanted me to have a bar mitzvah. And, you know, I'm not religious or anything. And even then, I didn't even give, who cares? But I found out that I could sing stuff. And by singing these prayers and stuff, I learned I had this huge voice, you know, this little kid with this really big voice. The cantor that was running the program, his name was Nate Lamb. If you look him up, he's the guy that at that time was getting really popular with John Travolta. He was teaching him to sing and a bunch of other people. So he was known as the cantor rabbi to the stars.
Oh, wow.
And, but to me, he was just Nate, and he was teaching me how to sing. Yeah. And that's what I got out of it. And so I was like, you know, I was hooked. I got in front of like 2,000 people up at Stephen S. Weiss. For those of you know, it's up in like Bel Air, and it's got a really kind of, at that time, a very wealthy congregation and kind of hoity-toity. And there were thousands of people would go to high holiday celebrations. So they had me get up and sing something. I got a standing ovation at 12 years old.
Well, wow. I don't doubt that.
That doesn't happen.
I don't doubt that.
You know, you don't do that generally. And so I kind of got a high off that. I was like, well, wait a minute, this could be something. What am I doing here? They wanted me to be a cantor. And I was like, no. I want to be Billy Joel. I want to be something.
Well, can I show some early Jeff? Because this was fantastic.
Yeah, that's great.
Look at this is Jeff.
It's about 15 or 16. Yeah.
That's about 15 or 16.
Yeah.
Then?
Yeah.
Look at this.
Okay.
My 335. I wish I had that.
Oh, now this brings up the next question. Jeff, what instrument did you start playing first?
You're looking at it. That guitar.
It was guitar.
Wow.
This black guitar in the middle.
Wow.
That is my 73 Les Paul. That was the first guitar I ever got. And then that one I bought later on when I was close to 18.
Wow.
I really didn't care about playing instruments. That wasn't really what was getting me. What was getting me was I could sing in front of people and they could react in a way that I thought was acceptable to me. I was like, more of this.
When you picked the guitar up, though, at what age was that?
14.
14.
Yeah, kind of late.
The time I started playing bass.
So what would you say this age is? About 16?
I'm almost 18 because I had the ES-335. I bought that with money I got from Hot Moves.
Wow.
Awesome. Okay, so how did you start on keyboard? Because, I mean, if anybody out there has seen this guy play the piano,
fantastic.
Incredible.
Yeah, incredible.
It's kind of a strange story. I'm a little more different than, let's say, guys that, you know, grew up to be piano players, you know.
Yes.
They might go to school and da 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 da. I wanted to be a singer. That's all I really, that was my whole focus, was to learn how to sing and sing songs. And I had a really high tenor voice and big voice, and that's you know, I mirrored guy. I wanted to be, you know, Steve Perry or Lou Gramm or guys like that, you know, Harry Nilsson, you know.
So what made you decide to play an instrument at all? Did you think, I need to start to accompany myself, or what did you think?
Well, what happened was I was playing, I realized I was singing other people's songs.
Yeah.
And I got a little kind of frustrated with it. Mm-hmm. And but while this time I was going to school and I can read and write music, you know, I was learning how to do that, but all based on a singer. So like I could write 4-part harmony and quartets and minuets and things like that in classical. Yeah. But I never applied it to an instrument. I applied it to vocals.
I see.
So to move to an instrument, it was just a matter of me getting my hands to where they were supposed to go, and then I could figure the rest out. So I started guitar because I'm left-handed mostly. I'm kind of ambi. But,
oh, yeah.
But the thing about that is that I learned how to play guitar like a right-handed person because I had the foresight for some reason. Don't have much foresight, but in this I did, to play a right-handed guitar so I could pick up a guitar anywhere I go.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm actually playing right-handed, but I'm actually a left-handed person.
Wow, that's interesting. That's yeah. That doesn't happen very often.
No, and during that time period in my life, you know, a few years before that, when I was in Little League, I couldn't decide if I was going to be a pitcher with left hand or right hand. So I had equal strength in both, and I still do. I can write my name, and I can write in one hand or the other. It really just wherever's the closest pen.
Wow, that's interesting. And I have both in my family, so I know that, you know, it's one or the other.
The thing about this is, like, if somebody were to hear you play the piano, they would have no idea that you were left-handed because you've got such great dexterity in your right hand. It's like, you know.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
But whatever know that, you know. I mean, oh, I'm sorry. What was that?
No, I didn't mean to interrupt you. I'm sorry.
No, I was going to say, when you hear Paul McCartney play, you know, you could see, oh, yeah, he's, you know, he's probably left-handed when he's playing because he doesn't do a whole lot with his right hand. But you're, like, all over the keyboard, man.
Well, the thing is, a piano is, you know, for rock piano, for piano and pop music, it's a right-hand dominant instrument because it's mostly melody and chords. The left hand on piano is bass. And if you're in a band, you don't want Jim to get mad at you, you know.
It's not pretty.
Oh, that's great.
But it's true. You know, you learn, you develop, you play. You play for the ensemble. You play as an ensemble. So in a piano, the piano is capable of handling. I don't need anybody. I could play the whole thing and be the whole band. But in a band situation, there's a role the piano is supposed to play, and bass is not one of them unless it's mirroring what you're doing.
Sure.
So you have to develop a strong right hand if you're playing, whether you're left-handed or not. You know.
Sure. I see what you're saying.
But anyway, I didn't learn piano. I had a few guitar lessons when I was about 13, 14. And I got to be honest, I learned enough guitar to like accompany me at a open mic or something
and write songs.
And then after that, it didn't really flip any switches for me. Mm-hmm. But there was a piano in the house and it wasn't meant for me.
Yeah.
The piano was for my sister, who was supposed to learn how to play piano, but she never touched it her whole life. Never. And now by this time I'm 14, 15 years old, and I keep walking past that piano and I'm like, I gotta figure this shit out. So I sat down at the piano and I pick, you know, I have my sheet music, which, you know, I had to figure out. And I just said, you know what? I'm gonna put all the letters on the notes on the keys. And
yes.
I did that 6 months to figure out what the keys were. And then I figured out chords. I also had you can't say too much about a great teacher. I mean, great teachers in your life can really, really set you on your way. Everett Gordon, he was a teacher of mine, and he was, he just happened to be, the conductor of the Boston Philharmonic.
Oh.
And he was, one of the Carpenter's musical directors.
Oh,
and I got, I don't know, my parents found this dude and hooked me up with him when I was 14. And so every day after school, or every twice a week, she would drive me over the hill to Hollywood, and I would spend 2 hours with this guy. And he taught me an amazing, amazing amount of information for a young guy to learn. You weren't going to get that kind of information sitting in a classroom. It was just unbelievable. And he was a phenomenal piano player. I mean, just the kind that you watch and be like, I want to be like that. So I said to him one day, I said, how do I play like that? And he said, well, you know, and he kind of showed me a few pointers, and then I went off on my own because I had such, he didn't give me instruction as a piano player, but I kept, I was there for vocals. He was my other vocal coach. He was sort of a musical guy. I used him for everything. When I was younger and 13 and 14, he was teaching me music and how, you know, kind of how to read and write music and stuff and how it applied to vocals. And then of course, Nate at the temple was teaching me actual, you know, voice control and all that. So I had the best of both worlds, but I kept pushing this teacher to teach me things I wanted. And he was like, yeah, sure, I'll teach you that. And so he taught me everything. We got into recording techniques, you know, we got into, cause he had a little 8-track there and I wanted to learn how'd you do that? How do you do that? I was, you know, I just sucked it all in like a huge sponge.
Wow. Wow.
But I taught myself how to play piano.
Yes.
Well,
that's incredible.
You have mastered it. I mean, you are amazing.
I've not mastered it.
Yeah, you have. I mean, I love every bit. Even the front intro of the promo video we played.
Yeah,
your work was just amazing and beautiful and
why it was so, I wouldn't say it was effortless at all, but the reason why I took to it is I was a singer, and all I did was take that energy from singing and applied it through an instrument. As I grew older and as I grew more confident with my abilities and skills, I realized that it doesn't really matter if I'm singing or if I'm playing piano. It's the same message.
You're right.
Absolutely.
How I want to divert that energy. And so I think what you're getting there is me singing on the piano instead of singing through my voice.
Sure. Yeah,
it just absolutely fills me. So, Jeff, tell us something. Okay, so we've talked about your piano and your guitar and music. Tell us something interesting maybe people don't know about you.
Well, let's see.
I know.
Oh, you mean my acting, my little crazy acting career?
Yes, a whole world. I think there's a whole world that people have no idea.
Yeah, you know, it's true. It's largely because I don't identify as an actor anymore. I really never did. I was in a show called The Too Short for Primetime Players, which was a funny little show that they put on at the Roxy on Sunset. On a Sunday, maybe it was a slow day for the Roxy. So they set up this thing with these producers and they convinced them to put a children's matinee show for birthday parties at the Roxy. All right. This was in the '80s and I was about 15 or 16 and, you know, I'm learning how to write songs. I got my guitar and I play a little keys and, I ended up writing songs I was the oldest one in the show. All the kids were from 5 years old to my age, but there were a lot of people you might bump into as time went on. I mean, there were people that were on sitcoms and, you know, people like Tracy Gold and all these people, Mark Price from, you know, another actor that's on with Michael J. Fox and all these like unknown, like child coming up people that were just looking for some attention. And I was in there going, oh my God, every Sunday I can write music. I can produce a show or be part of producing a show. It's kind of what I'm doing now, only I'm not getting paid for it. But this is great experience. And who cared about money? I was still living. I was 15. You know, I was living. It was like money was my goal. So this was fantastic. It became popular among LA, you know, sort of like in vogue. It got really kind of a buzz about it. And somebody sent some talent managers from the Merv Griffin show.
Oh, wow.
To do an expose. And they elected or selected, three or four of us to go on the Merv Griffin show and promote the show by singing something or doing what we do. And I was on with Jerry Lewis. And so he had nothing to do with the show, but for some reason they brought him on that day, I guess, comic relief or whatever. And in case we bombed, I don't know. Anyway, so I get to the Merv Griffin show. This is exciting. This is national television, you know. Merv Griffin show, for all that don't know, that are really young, kind of like Fallon, you know. It was like Johnny Carson and Michael Douglas were kind of rivals in their time slots, and later on it became Fallon and Jay Leno or something. But anyway, So we did the show. I did the show, and they would not let me sing my own song. And that was the whole thing. I was like, wait, I get to sing my own material. This is awesome, you know?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I was a big mouth little 15-year-old, and I was pissed off. I had to pick from a list of songs that were pre-published okay, you know, that were considered they wouldn't get in trouble for because they had some kind of publishing deal. Anyway, I picked, believe it or not, The Best of Times by Styx. And I sang that
that song.
Yeah, I know. Dennis DeYoung was my hero forever. And I have a little story about him, but I can tell you that later. But I ended up meeting him a few years later in a completely unrelated incident, acting related, not singing related. But anyway, so The Best of Times, I sang that on TV, and that kind of started things off. I did that, and I got I was around all these kids that had agents and stuff.
Yes. So
they were looking at me, meaning their people. And so this dude, forgot his name, but anyway, he was Richard Galley was his name. He was an agent for all these little kids, you know? Okay. And he said, I'm like, well, I don't know anything about acting. And he's like, well, you don't need to, you're young and you could play 14 forever. You I was like, oh, okay, whatever. So, I mean, you never say no, right? It's the business. So
sure,
they sent me out a bunch of commercials. I never got any of them. And I kept saying to my agent, send me out on some movies. I want to do a movie. I don't like Burger King. Send me out.
I want the big boys.
Yeah. All right.
So you got the big boys.
So they sent me out on some acting roles, and I was getting them. They were little bit parts, but I got a few. And the first thing I got was Hot Moves, was a movie.
And I have to tell you, I'm gonna post the URL for this. You guys have to go on and watch this. This is super fun.
Yeah, but be high first.
there's a lot of it was hilarious because I would say the first 5 minutes of the movie were a lot of like hot pods. A lot of hot pods, and you were pretty fun. I watched it. It was pretty fun.
The best part of the movie is the opening montage. The rest of it is all downhill. I knew nothing about acting.
Someone's lap. I saw that.
They sent me my first day on the set. It was in Venice Beach. Anyway, it was very, very difficult because by the time I was 17 or 18, I think I was 17 when I did that movie. I wouldn't say I was accomplished, but I knew how to, you know, I could play, and I could sing. I mean, I had confidence that if you asked me to play something or sing something, I could do it. I didn't have any confidence with acting. I never even tried it. And here I am in front of cameras and all this stuff. And, you know, it was kind of nerve wracking for someone who was a little bit of a perfectionist, you know?
So for those of you who don't know, left-hand bottom screen is Jeff is the one with the sunscreen on his nose.
Zinc oxide, yeah.
Yes, yes.
The zinc oxide.
Zinc oxide. It was pretty funny. I actually watched the first 10 to 15 minutes of that. And
it's
was
a shame movie.
Yeah. It was pretty fun. But you moved on to a pretty successful movie after that. One of the most successful movies even today.
I mean, Karate Kid, we could have a show on, like, you could do a whole show on that. There's so much information there. But just to give you the quick bullet point, I interviewed for that job for John Avildsen directly, the director. And John, and most people know, if they don't know, John Avildsen was the Rocky director. He directed Rocky I. And they wanted a guy, and they wanted everything in the movie to have a Rocky kind of quality to it. Jerry Weintraub produced it. He also produced Rocky. You know, that's why so many, you know, Scotty Brothers Records was involved in some of the soundtrack stuff, and they were involved in some of the music for Rocky, you know? So, I mean, there were a lot of Rocky connections there, but it's exciting because at the time I even knew who John Avildsen was. I mean, we all, you know, Rocky was a big movie. And so it was exciting. And it was supposed to be a 2-week deal for me. I was just supposed to get a, you know, a walk, basically what you see there, a walk on the beach. But mm-hmm. it's kind of interesting how Hollywood works. It's I got the gig. And after I got the gig, they extended my contract throughout the indefinitely, meaning until they finished shooting. They weren't sure, you know, just what we were going to do in the movie. Mm-hmm. If you put that picture back up, there's some interesting people in it. I mean, you can see Elizabeth Shue sitting down.
Oh, yeah, right here. Yep.
Next to me is Israel Warby, who is in 48 Hours later on. Ken Daly, I don't know what happened to him. He's the guy without the shirt. But if you look in the back, walking toward the water, that's Frankie Avalon Jr.
Wow. Oh, yeah. That's so amazing.
What Frankie Avalon and I were about the same age at the time. You know, he was a drummer. He still is. He works with his dad. But what's interesting about that is everybody, we had so much time on our hands in that movie. And Billy Zabka, me, Frankie, a couple of the other guys, we would go up to Frankie Avalon's house in Hidden Hills and get high and jam. After it was just, you know, it was just a weird.
And are you still connected? Do you still have contact with these people today? Or is it?
I do. I have talked to Frankie. Not this year. I mean, I don't talk to him often. We're not like, you know, close anymore, but yeah, I have, especially since Cobra Kai. We've all kind of started talking again. It's sure. kind of oh, yeah. a lot of conversations starting up again. But yeah, so that was supposed to be a quick 2-week deal that turned into like 3 months. And they paid me to stay home or paid me to sit in my trailer. So
sure.
And every day I'd come to work and I'd look at my lines and there'd be redacted scenes. Forget lines, redacted scenes.
Yeah,
it was Columbia Pictures, and they had a lot more money than Hot Moves.
Yeah,
and so they had a lot of great. But I met so many. And Pat Morita was amazing to work with, to talk to that guy.
Yeah,
And everybody, Chad McQueen, you know, Steve McQueen's kid was in that. He's not a kid anymore. In that, and there were just everybody was connected to somebody except me. I was sort of like flailing in the wind here, but. But it was, in retrospect, it was a phenomenal, I would never want to trade that experience for anything.
What a great experience. But if you had to take acting and music, would music be a slam dunk for you?
Oh, yeah. Oh, when I finished Karate Kid, there was a couple more little parts I was trying to get and a few more things. I mean, to be honest with you, I went on every John Hughes movie. I met all those guys. I did with I ended up doing a video with Patrick Swayze, but that's a whole nother thing. I didn't even bring that up in the notes. But Patrick Swayze, remember there was a band, see, I'm already thinking music. There was a movie called Red Dawn. You remember Red Dawn?
One of my favorites. I don't know if you know Red Dawn, but I absolutely, I actually bought the VHS of Red Dawn.
Did you?
Right. Red Dawn was, I did a, there were just all the Rat Pack Packers not the Rat Packers, you know, everyone from, you know, all those guys, Rob Lowe, all of them auditioned for it. They all were in that circle and, you know, Michael Hall, all of them. And none of these people were big stars yet. It was right before Breakfast Club broke and they were just dudes like me, kind of like had a couple gigs, you know, and were kind of trying to make their way. And so I went on, I went out on all those John Hughes movies. I didn't get any. I wasn't getting them. And I think the reason was is they were actors. I'm a musician thinking, well, I make money, let's do this. And then I looked at myself one day, I think I was like 20. It was right after Karate Kid was released and became a hit. And I was going, I'm not getting any work. The last thing I did that anyone cared about was Karate Kid. And I'm like, where's my music? So I dove back into music head first. I mean, I went and put bands together and I kind of, I felt like I lost 2 years. And that's like 20 when you're 18.
Yeah.
You know? Yes, yeah, sure.
So, I mean, I don't have any regrets, but at the time it was very, very frustrating for me. You know, I didn't see it as a benefit. I saw it as it was holding me back.
Sure, sure. Well, what, when you did get back into the music situation, what was the first band that you started playing in or started?
The first band was a band called The Reach. And interestingly enough, the guitar player, his name is Patrick Bolin. He was in Pure Prairie League for a little while. And he toured with Kenny Rogers and Kim Carnes. And we ended up writing songs together. I don't have any pictures of that. I should have given you something. And I do have studio recordings. Now, there's a Survivor connection here.
Oh, okay. Even,
now, there was a Survivor connection with Karate Kid. I didn't know about 30 years later. Survivor, we got to go back. Survivor had the theme song for the Karate Kid.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
That was the song that they used to promote the movie with. The moment of truth.
Yep.
Okay, so that was their connection. Now they did Rocky III and Rocky IV with Eye of the Tiger and Burning Heart. Yep. But Karate Kid, they were kind of forced to do that song. They didn't write that song. That was written by Bill Conti, who wrote the score to Rocky.
Oh, okay.
Interesting.
I know, da 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 da. Yes, he wrote that. He wrote the song with Peter Beckett, Moment of Truth. And they forced Survivor to play it because they had that hit song. They had a song that was similar that they, anyway, they wouldn't let them. No, they already had, Eye of the Tiger. It was already out. It was 83. Okay. So by this time it was 84. So they wanted that band, but they wanted them to sing that song. That's why we never played it live. When I played with them 30 years later, I never played Moment of Truth. I asked them about it.
And that was going to be my next question was, do you guys play that live now?
I wish we did, because so many people ask for it. And I the mean, truth
you,
is,
you really don't. They you don't can't, play it live. Why don't you play it live?
It's not a song they wrote.
What?
Yeah.
But it's a song that people would want to hear.
That's not how they operate. Next question.
Wow.
That's
funny. Wow.
I mean, you know, when you get into that level of success with some bands, you can't really question their motives all the time, because it's such a different experience than you know. I mean, you're in a very successful tribute band, but you can't make the same decisions that John Paul Jones would be making. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you just don't know what your life is going to and how that's going to develop through the years. So you got to kind of stand back and go, hey. This is your game.
Yes. So what year did you join Survivor? And I mean, Survivor, I have to say, Survivor, Europe, Asia, all those bands. I loved all those bands.
Yeah.
But those were 80s bands. So what year did you join Survivor?
2017.
Wow. I mean, was that your era? Because I know it was our era. I mean, we're just loving every minute.
Well, obviously, it was 83 when, or 82 perhaps, when Rocky 3 came out, 82 or 83. And it was a monster ass hit. I mean, that was, you don't get hits like every day. It's like one in a lifetime, you know? And that song, Eye of the Tiger, was, you couldn't escape. Everyone, you were like, everyone learned it, you know?
Yes.
I mean, he taught. Well, I can tell you other stories about that song, but I won't get too far off the subject. The point is that was it my era? Yeah. But I mean, Survivor wasn't like a favorite band of mine. Mm-hmm. I was kind of into like, well, they hate it when I told them this. Styx was really my thing. Okay.
Yeah. Favorite.
Yeah. Well, Dennis DeYoung and a couple of the guys, I don't know if you know this, but they all write songs together back then even. And they live down the street from each other even now.
August. Sure.
And they have like this little funny rivalry when you talk about. But my first time with them in the car, I was telling them, I'm a big Styx fan, because we were talking about something. I know why. Well, and they're like, okay, stop the car, let him out. You know, that kind of thing. It was all, you know, Tommy Shaw was on almost every one of those early records of Survivor. Really? He's singing back.
Right?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
I didn't know that either. I didn't know that. Yeah.
You may not know that Frankie Sullivan and Jim Peterick, the two main writers, they wrote songs for 38 Special. So they wrote Hang On Loosely.
Oh, yeah. And,
you know, the other big hit they had. They wrote the two biggest hits. Someone will correct. Someone will know.
Yeah, yeah, somebody will write that in there.
38 Special was amazing.
Yeah, yeah, so they were. Yeah, and of course, Jim Peterick, you know, came from the Ides of March. And so he had that song, Vehicle.
Vehicle, yeah, that's right.
So they were like this, they were like a Lennon McCartney writing duo. They weren't really a band, so to speak. You know, right, they may have been for two records and then they kind of had different guys. That's a band. You just thought
that's a band.
So we're going to move on to
K-Tel.
Yeah.
Now, I remember talking to Larry when all of this was going on.
Larry Hampton, you're talking about.
Yes, Larry Hampton, lead guitar player from K-Tel. But I don't know, how did that all come together? How did that get put together?
I don't know either. No, I'm just kidding.
But you guys are fantastic in every way. Oh, and I'm telling you, I have been your number one fan from the word.
I think you're right. I think that's you two guys have been right there. I mean, So we love you guys so much. The thing is about that band, I think I can speak for everyone in it. There's a personal love we have for that era, that particular group of guys playing that music at this time. It just, you know, we don't even need an audience. We have a good time.
No, and there's so much energy and there's just so much magic. From the first time I saw K-Tel, and it was very early, I think, when you guys started doing it, I came home and I said, there is something special about this band.
Yeah.
The same way. No, I was just agreeing with Brenda. I feel special. Yeah. It's got a special place in my heart, too.
Well, I mean, the thing I love about it is that it's not a cover band in the sense that where you guys just get together and you say, hey, you know, okay, let's do that song, that song. What's the chords to that? You guys dig in there and play it with detail.
That is
so rare in a cover band situation. And it puts you guys on top in my mind. I hear you.
You know, I mean, you know, I'll say this, take it with a grain of salt a little bit what I'm going to say, because it's meant in a good way. The reason why I'm not in a lot of perhaps tribute bands, because I've been asked to be in a bunch, and I tend to shy away from them a little bit, because I have a very strong sense of, I've been a solo artist for so long, and I don't always tend to enjoy impersonating. You know, it's fun on a particular song or for a particular thing. But when K-Tel came around, I mean, it was like, wait, I got to do this.
Yes.
This is cool. I get to play these songs. I can still be who I am.
Yeah.
But I can create a character. Sure. And I can be part of this era as if. And so we all felt that way. We've all seen, you know, Kenny Metcalf is amazing as Elton.
Oh, yeah.
That's a whole different kind of approach to tributing that music. Sure, we just thought, well, with K-Tel, you know, one of the ways that we could sell this is, you know, why hire one tribute band when you can hire them all? You know, let's make these songs. First of all, we love this music and it's not being played. So let's play it like it deserves to be played and not like at 1 o'clock in the morning in a bar somewhere, you know, and you hear a bunch of drunk people singing along to, you know, My Sharona or something, you know, with a guitar player that's just kind of not really learning the parts. The point is that this stuff was, well, I mean, we're all songwriters. We're all people that came from an era when we may not have all grown up in the 70s, but we're old enough to know what the craft is.
Yeah.
My son. But I was just going to say, you, like in the K-Tel every single musician, when you just, if you were to isolate every single musician, stellar. So you guys are offering,
I'm telling, great vocalists too.
I mean, musicians. There is not one weak link in your band.
Not at all.
So when you guys come together as a unit, it is just, it is like when I first saw your band, I told you, I was a fan from the word go. I was,
it's a great band. I mean, you know, it, that kind of talent, I guess, or that kind of, you know, the fact that we're all kind of, we all kind of stand on our own, doesn't come without pain.
Yeah.
There's a lot of cooks in that kitchen.
Yeah. You know, you're right.
All like, I could sing that song. Well, yeah, so can I. And I can sing that song, or I should play that song. So, you know, we have a little bit of that going on, but you know, it's healthy. It's healthy. You know what I mean?
Sure. Yeah.
It's not like everybody in that band has one role and one role only. We're capable of so many that we try our hardest to really kind of put the talent where it needs to be for that song. You know, like each song's a movie. You want to cast the right guy kind of thing.
Sure, sure. And you've got such great choices and so many.
So we're very lucky to have the ability to have those choices. We don't have, I mean, Michael O'Mara is a fantastic frontman, great singer, but hey, he doesn't have to sing Brandy because we got a guy that actually sounds like the guy that sings Brandy. So he's cool with that. We kind of shift it to the drums and then, you know what I'm saying? So,
sure,
I mean,
sure.
Who better in the band to sing Lady, you know?
Oh,
I mean, you know, by Atlanta Rhythm Section.
I have to tell you.
Got that soft, sexy voice. Why force the singer to do that when we got a guy that sounds more like that? So we have the ability to kind of shift.
Sure.
So when Seth did Brand, is it Seth?
Seth, yes.
I probably stood there in shock. I couldn't move. I was just watching him.
I know, that's ridiculous, that, isn't
the
it?
Voice, the voice that came out of you and the voice that came out, I was in shock. I was just like,
well, most bands don't have that many guys that can sing lead well.
It was amazing.
But they did in the 70s.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, you're right.
I was like, I need to sit down right now. I just want to sit and watch this band.
Yeah, I know. It's mind-blowing.
And I cannot wait till we get this World's Greatest back up and running. We were going to do a World's Greatest, I think, in 21, and the, Katie and I decided to kind of let this thing ride and see where we're going.
Yeah.
But 2023. Well, 2022.
We're not going to do it this year?
No, we need to
already,
go.
We're halfway through the year, Jim.
2022. Yeah, yeah, that's true.
2023. Jim's trying to push for 2022. 2023, we're going to get up and running. We're going to get this thing going again.
Slow down.
I know, Jim's freaking me out here.
That brings us to another subject. So how did you become involved in Robert Plant Nation? Because that's another phenomenal band that a lot of people aren't even aware of.
I'm going to laugh because it was you. You did it.
Jim Mouton, he's always the culprit.
I just wanted everybody else to know that, Jeff.
It just feels like it's your birthday. I don't know. It's your birthday every day.
Every day. Welcome to my life, Jeff.
So I knew Swan. I didn't know him particularly well. I knew him, obviously, from Zeppigan. And met him a couple times, but nothing real, you know, not anything like we were friends, so to speak. And then I think he was looking to do something a little different to kind of supplement his Robert Plant stuff. And I guess, honestly, Sky. He's blaming you that I'm in his life now. That's great. Love you, Scott.
I think Scott's on a ship right now, actually.
I think he is.
No, he's not. Yeah. Is he really?
He is. He's on a ship with Zeppigan.
Yeah.
Oh, yep. I didn't even know he left. Oh, okay. So anyway, so I think you suggested me. That's what I thought.
Yeah, that's right.
And,
yeah,
and,
that's
and exactly. And just gave me a call.
Yeah. Yeah. No. When Swan mentioned that he wanted to put that together, I said, "Oh man, look no further when you need a keyboard player." And so,
thank you,
and Scott, and it's a phenomenal group. I've seen it several times.
So good.
We have tried to, those songs stretch a 20-year span.
Yes.
From like 1980s to kind of now, really. So much more than 20 years. And the bulk of those albums, Fate of Nations and the like, and Zen and Now, and those albums were not actually played live very often. If they were, they were done with one tour and then they were done. And so the majority of that material has never actually been recreated as it is on the record by anyone, including Robert Plant. And so we just set out to take on a monumental task to try to recreate what it would be like if a band were to recreate those, in that era.
Yes.
And so again, it's similar to K-Tel in that we do very little, K-Tel doesn't do any tracks. There's very little, there's some sound effects and things we do.
Sure.
But everything's played by us, we do it to the best of our ability. And I got to tell you, it ain't easy to pull off because
in the
80s, they used a lot of sequencer stuff and keyboards that don't exist anymore. And some of his material, I don't want to get too off that subject, but some of Robert Plant's material was very experimental. Mm-hmm. He was trying really hard not to sound like the radio and didn't want to sound like Zeppelin. That was the two big criteria. He didn't care what it sounded. And some of it is just not that great. There's some of it. I could pull up some of the B-sides of some of these stuff. And you'd be like, oh, okay, that goes on for 14 minutes. That's enough. but it's mixed in with just unbelievable, Ship of Fools is one of my favorite songs ever written.
That's 100%. A phenomenal piece. Yeah. It really
now and then's probably my favorite album of that time period with Robert Plant. Who else would want to do that? Swan. Sure. Makes total sense.
Right.
But unfortunately, we started that band when COVID started.
Yep.
And that was great timing. we're doing our best to kind of play catch up.
And a lot of people, Ragdolls, a lot of people. So K-Tel, a lot of people started
just
and
prior
we,
to
yeah, it's just
made it hard for everybody to take off.
I didn't know that. Yeah. I mean, it certainly kind of slowed us down, and we were starting to kind of pick up a little. I think we did the Access show in 20.
We did a month before the COVID shut us down.
Was we don't even have the same lineup. We have a different drummer, different bass player now. But in that time, we were just getting started, and it's been slower than I wanted it to be. But when people see this, if people get a chance to see this, they're going to be like, why haven't I heard of this?
It's
really entertaining. And what I like about it more than anything is that this isn't something you're going to see a band do.
No,
nobody is going to cover seven notes. Go to a bar. You're never going to see these songs ever. You're not going to see Robert Plant do them. So if you want to see Ron do them, you got to come to a show.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And Swan's the best. He's amazing.
Yes,
he nails it. So
I know.
It's amazing.
I know, and it's really fitting that he does Robert Plant after Zeppelin, because and I mean this in a really good way. He's sort of matured into the role of just like Robert Plant has.
Yeah,
you're right.
His own kind of thing, because he was a kid in Zeppelin.
Well, he's 30 years. Right. He's been 30 years doing Zeppelin, and he's matured into the Robert Plant role. You're right.
There are times I'll listen to some rehearsal tapes or something from a and I'll close my eyes. I'm like, is that plant or is that swan? You know, and it's just, he's just, he nails swan. He nailed, I was going to say, Robert Plant nails swan.
It does. Right. It's almost becoming that. Yeah.
Well, you know, one other group that we didn't mention that I know that you just started working with recently is Venice.
Oh, yeah.
What is that?
Can I tell you a funny story? So, you know Nancy Sauter-Roost, right?
Obviously, she passed away.
Yeah. So she contacted me a month, unfortunately, before she passed away. And you know I do the tumblers. Well, she hired me to make a tumbler for every single member of the band. So mm-hmm. I made a tumbler for every single member of the band.
Yeah.
I sent it to them. And then she passed away 3 weeks later. And it was the saddest thing.
Yeah.
But I felt so privileged that I literally listed every single member of the band of Venice. And she presented it to them.
Yeah.
And then she passed. It was the saddest thing ever.
We were talking about great vocal groups, though.
Oh, yeah. I mean, they are phenomenal. I mean, first of all, they have all the same DNA. So when they're singing, it just, you know, brothers and cousins, they're unbelievable. But everyone knows that. I mean, that's what they're, you know, they've played with every from Jackson Browne to Steely Dan to Jeff Skunk Baxter. I mean, they've done, you know, the Roger Waters tour, they were the backup vocals for The Wall. These guys are just phenomenal singers.
Jeff, have you ever seen them, the video that they did with David Crosby doing the song?
Yeah.
I
know. You're just like, I quit. That's it.
So good. And, you know, Kip
Lennon. Playing with them was a big, big honor for me because I grew up in the 80s. I had cover bands in the 80s and I was trying to do my own original thing in the 80s. But everybody knew Venice over down at a place called At My Place in Santa Monica. They were sort of a regular there. I don't know if you remember At My Place, Brenda. It was on Santa Monica.
What was it? It was in Santa Monica?
It was called At My Place.
I don't think my parents allowed me to go to Santa Monica.
in your 20s? Really? You had strict parents.
In my 20s. But in my 20s, I had children. So yes. So when I was 20, I had my first child. So
yeah.
Yeah. You were having fun. Anyway. I was not. I was working two jobs.
Well, I mean, all fun and no play makes Brenda. Yeah.
I'm having fun now.
Kip Lennon, he used to tour with David Crosby all the time. And there's a live version of him doing the song Hero that Phil Collins and David Crosby did together.
Hero.
No, I'm not going to sing that song for you. You haven't played it yet.
No, I felt like I might know that song.
But he did a live version of it, and Phil Collins did the original, and I was just blown away by how good Kip Lennon.
Kip is playing with Ambrosia next month.
He's with Ambrosia now?
Ambrosia plays at the Canyon.
Yeah, well, they're going to be at the Nugget. I'm going to go see them. Yeah. They're up here in Vegas coming. They've been actually... Kip, I think, had a COVID scare, so he had to cancel. Or they had a COVID scare in the band, so he had to cancel. But he's been playing with Ambrosia pretty regularly.
Wow!
Now, is he singing lead with the group?
Yeah, he's. Well, I think they have more than one singer. So in a show, they're doing, like, from what he told me, I think he's not singing every song. He's singing like they split it up.
At the Canyon. I see.
Yeah, that was years ago, but I don't think he was in the group.
But to hear him sing How Much I Feel, that's enough for price of admission right there.
Yes.
I'm about to break into that right now.
Huh?
I said I'm about to break into that right now.
Please resist the urge.
Well, he's not going to sing Hero, so go for it.
Yeah.
I'm going to do it. I'm not going to embarrass Jim Wooten, but I'll do it.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah. Now, tell us a little bit about your composing career, Jeff.
Well, it's never really stopped. I've been writing forever. I mean, I started out as a songwriter. You know, singing and songwriting. That's every time I learned a new chord, I wanted to write a new song with it. You know, it's like, you know, it's just, they go together for me. And so I was always figuring out ways to, you know, plug songs, get songs places. I did a video back in the early 90s, it had to be the 80s. Anyway, It was called Swayze Dancing with Patrick Swayze and his mother, believe it or not. She apparently, it's a long story, but anyway, I'll just give you a short one. She apparently taught her children how to dance. Wow. And so I was working with a guy named Mark Lempkin, who was, believe it or not, the stage manager for Seals and Crofts.
And
he had a whole bunch of other little side careers, and some of them weren't. Whatever. He was kind of a seedy dude, but he convinced Patrick Swayze's mother from Texas to put a video together. It was back in the day when video, there was no Netflix. So you had to go to Blockbuster video kind of thing. And, I have about three or four songs I wrote for that. And, Patrick Swayze's in it. And, they got him to do some cameos and stuff. And so from that time period, I met different producers and different people that were doing music for home video, as they called it then. Yes. And so I have a huge catalog of things. Nowadays, I've got, my catalog is, you know, I can't tell you how many shows I'm on. Honestly, and I mean that literally, I can't tell you. I don't know. I just get to look at the ASCAP statement and go, oh, I'm on that show. Oh, I'm on that show. There's just a, you know, maybe 100 different TV shows and cable shows that have, you know, that have used my music or some parts of it. So I wouldn't call it a career because I haven't had a hit song, which is something I always wanted. You know, I had a publishing deal with A&M for a little while. They were kind of grooming me to be, back in those days, you get a publishing deal and then a record deal. So they would kind of like, you know, develop you as a songwriter and then pitch you. And then when they pitch you, you would get a better deal, whatever. Long story. So back then it was like 1990 or something. And, I got signed to, at the time it was called Almo-Irving. It's now Rondor Music, and that was really exciting because I had an opportunity. It didn't grow into the opportunity I wanted it to, but I had the potential opportunity of writing with Sting or Bryan Adams or anyone that's on A&M's label. I have to go back in my memory, but there were some pretty big writers that I got to write some songs with that are kind of well known, and I never got a hit though. So, you know, it's like people only remember you if you got a hit record. All the songs that have been written, you know, that have stories attached to them, they just aren't hits. So
sure.
I have a fun question for you, because this is my favorite pastime. If you were to get in a Mustang convertible, a red Mustang convertible, and drive the coast, what would be your band, or what would be the music that you would want to play while you were driving the coast, while the left hand side was your ocean and the right-hand side was the road? What would be the band that you would put in the... It's not even CD player anymore. What would you Bluetooth to the radio?
I would say... it would have to be a compilation of things. You know... I don't want to date myself, because I mean I love so, I mean I listen to stuff from today as well, but you know, I'm a big America fan.
America. Man, are you kidding, Jim?
So you got the ocean on your left hand side.
Exactly. I mean, Ventura Highway, you're not gonna put that on? You're kidding me?
I didn't know you liked America.
We love America.
Oh my god.
America.
We had an America.
We love America.
Oh, I remember. I think I heard about that. Yeah. You're not doing that still, are you?
What was that?
Is that still happening?
We haven't done that in years. It was with Bill Worrell. You remember Bill?
I know him. Yeah.
And he was
the Chicago thing, right?
Yeah. Yeah. That's right. And he was playing with America for about 2.5 years.
That's right. Yeah.
And during that time, he was still playing with the Long Run. And he says, hey, why don't we do an America tribute band? So we did that. But then he ended up moving.
Yeah, Bill moved.
There is so much good music that came out of those guys.
Yeah.
How many damn hits they had.
Oh, my God. But you're right. America's a good band to drive the coast to. So I have one more hard question for you, Jeff.
What's that?
If you were to join a tribute, what would be the ultimate?
No, start a tribute. If you were to start one to any band.
Join or start. What would be the ultimate tribute? I mean, wipe away everything you've done.
Yeah.
If someone were to say, Jeff, Bryan, I'm going to put you in the best tribute ever, what would be your tribute?
Tribute. Yeah. I mean, you're going to hate my answer. I'm already in. I'm already in the K-Tel.
Yeah.
I know that's kind of a cheap answer for you, but the truth is that I'm not, I grew up, just so you know, I grew up listening to songs, not listening to artists. I wasn't one of these guys that was a fanboy of Billy Joel or Elton John or Steve Perry or whatever. I liked them and I emulated some of them, especially Dennis DeYoung, but I was attracted to the material. So if I could listen to a song and appreciate a song that wasn't someone I liked.
Yeah.
And so K-Tel gives me that ability to play every song from all these artists. I mean, I guess if I had to pick one, Jerry Rafferty. I mean, this guy's so underrated.
Yeah. Right. Oh, he was great. Okay. He was so good. But what about this though, Jeff? I mean, there's a few Styx tributes.
AHJ. Thank you, Scott.
93 KH. There you go, Scott.
Machine Gun Kelly.
Yeah, you don't remember that.
So
station?
Larry Leon says KHJ. KHJ.
AM radio from the 70s.
AM radio from the 70s. Okay.
And does anyone remember Machine Gun Kelly from KHJ?
Oh, absolutely.
You do. I don't.
No, I remember Machine Gun
Kelly. By the way, Scott gets it. Scott gets it. He knows.
Yeah, Scott.
93 KHJ is the K-Tel set list.
There you go. There. And what about Don
Steele? He's on fire.
You remember the real Don Steele?
Yes, with the bomb.
But Jeff, what about this? I mean, I'm sure that there's a ton of Styx tributes out there. You would be a perfect fit for that.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. I know.
You ever think about
it? All right, Jeff, can I call you after the show?
Yeah.
I don't want to sound like an ass. I want to be honest. Mm-hmm. I've met some of these people, you know, touring with Survivor. I've met some of the guys from Styx. I don't know if I want to tribute people that I've met, you know, being in Survivor and being around. I mean, we toured with Cheap Trick. We toured with Lita Ford. We toured Loverboy. And I got to meet these people and talk to them. And, I don't know. It's just, it's why Fool's Logic was so attractive to me. It's like, nobody knows what these guys look like or what they were supposed to act like.
And
don't get me wrong. I love the tribute community. These guys are phenomenal players. They're all like super hyper nerds about the music, which is really cool. It's just a personal thing. You know, there are some things I feel comfortable doing as me and some things I don't. And, I don't know if I think that if this was maybe if we were younger and this was 20 years from now and Styx was no longer with us and maybe that would be more comfortable, you know? I don't know. Well, it's not a satisfying answer, I'm sure, but it's how I feel.
No,
it's
totally
an honest answer,
that.
Though. But that's what we want.
What about, is there anything on the horizon for Fool's Logic or is that dead?
Yeah, actually there is. I think I can tell you this. Gary Hagen joined us.
That's
you know Gary.
Awesome. Yes, absolutely. Yes, so
we love Gary. We love Gary.
He's back. I think he's the one who recruited me And then he left the band before we did a gig. I'm like, thanks, Gary. You know?
And now it's time to make up for last time.
He plays with the Mirage now and then, you know. We're thinking of doing, we've been asked to do a double bill with Mirage, which might be a kind of a cool thing. Paula is probably going to have us back. The problem with Fool's Logic is I don't think the people that are booking know what it is or who, or if it has any, it doesn't seem to have I got to have that appeal when they're booking us, you know, but every time we do really well. It's a great band. It's a lot of work, you know, because two keyboard players, Matt Brown, you know, there's a ton of work that has to be, plus we, you know, all the bumpers and the music that we put in between, and we put a whole freaking show together. Sure. And it would be nice to get more gigs, but yeah, it's sort of an ongoing project that hopefully will work more in the future.
Is there a tentative date for that show?
Let you know. In fact, just 2 days ago, I got a call from Smitty about possibly doing something at the Canyon.
Oh, that's awesome.
Great.
With Mirage. But I don't know if that's been decided yet.
We'll be there.
And Paula Casino is asking us back too. I just don't have a date.
Okay. So what is the next show you got happening with K-Tel local? Is there
K-Tel's on fire right now. So it's awesome. In a good way, not like a dumpster fire. A really good one. Like a bonfire.
Like a bonfire.
Right.
Like Firefall. There we go. Let's keep it in the center. So we've got gigs. We've got corporate gigs coming up. We're going to be going to Ohio in July 1st and 2nd. We've got Veterans Park, which, you know, usually has a couple thousand people. It's pretty big show. And then we've got a corporate that weekend. There is a bunch of shows. We're playing the Hermosa Beach Festival.
We're going to be there because Hermosa. Deja Vu's playing the night before. Yep. So we're going to spend the night
You know, maybe I'll convince April to do that too. And we'll hang out or something. And then, let's see. There's so many that I can't remember. We've got this big, I think Brenda, your son got us a gig, believe it or not, on a yacht.
On a yacht for JB Hunt. Yes.
It's a pretty handsome gig too. So we're really excited to take it. That's in San Diego. That's in a month or two. I don't remember the exact date, but we have a bunch of things going on. I think I can talk about it. I've got an agent in Florida that is putting together sort of like a 70s review, and she does it every year. And up until I met her, she didn't know K-Tel existed. And she contacted me and said, look, I do the 70s thing. And I bring on all the original songwriters and singers of your set list. Not every song, but a lot of them.
Wow. Incredible, Jeff.
I mean, the guy from Rare Earth, the drummer, you know, Bill Champlin. Elliot Laurie, the Brandy singer. The guy that wrote Rosemary, Love Goes When My Rosemary. The guy that does the Archies. Sugar, the whole crew of these guys. Peter Beckett from Player, he's another one.
Man. Do you have an idea of when that might happen? Or
it's going to happen this fall or toward the end of the summer. She's getting contracts, and what we're going to do is it's going to allow us to put on our K-Tel show, and then bring up the actual guy that sings.
That's awesome.
We're going to, you know, we'll be his band for that moment. And then he goes off, we continue on with the show. And then we bring another guy up to do a couple more songs from his catalog.
I've got to see this.
It's going to be called the Totally 70s Show, featuring the K-Tel All-Stars and then a list of stars.
That's so
just,
cool.
Just a little, I'll be on that yacht with you.
she is going to be.
Devin put me on the guest list. Yeah.
You get another K-Tel show. Nice.
I think Shannon Ray and I are going
Peter
on the
Rivera. Someone wrote Peter Rivera. I can't see you. Who wrote that? Scott. Well, Jesus, Scott. He's on fire.
I know. Scott.
I want Scott everywhere I go. I just want him texting me. so I don't forget anything.
Oh, man. Well, thank you so much for being with us tonight,
how much
Jeff.
Fun did we have? So much fun. It was a blast. So much fun. You are I always tell Jim, when you sit down at a keyboard, it is heaven.
That's very nice of you to say. Yeah, I appreciate it.
Amazing. Oh, man. It's amazing in every way. That is my favorite instrument, by the way.
Is it really?
Absolutely. Yeah.
I didn't know that.
No, keyboard and sax are my two.
Oh,
my
two. Well, I guess I'll
something need about it.
Wow. You know, Jim, there's something you're doing right. To say
he's cute. He's cute.
It ain't the sax.
Yeah, there you go. That's right. That's right. Yeah. Oh, man, Jeff. Well, thank you so much, man. And we're looking forward to seeing you.
So let's talk about you guys. Visit www.jeffreybryanmusic.com, Spotify, yeah. Amazon, and Apple Music.
There we go. Yeah.
Some amazing, amazing music. Download these tunes. I certainly am going to do that.
Well, if they've got the subscription to them.
Yep.
Yeah,
yep.
You can just look it up.
Yep.
Jeffrey Bryan. Yeah.
It's amazing. Yeah,
during 2020, I have a lot of songs I haven't finished, and so I just had a lot of time. So I started buttoning them up and kind of getting them ready. And I published a bunch of original tunes. You're going to have to search for them.
Well, I did. I searched for all of them. I listened to them. And they were amazing.
Also released part of the catalog, which is more of it's not songs. They're instrumental cinematic stuff.
Oh, and very
that's,
cool.
That's what you know. That's what the other one. I mean, if you go up there, you'll see there's different albums.
Yes.
Cool. Anyway, you can get there from their website, so it's easy to
right here. There JeffreyBryanMusic.com. You guys go on. You can download off of Spotify, Amazon, and Apple Music.
You can stream on that.
Yeah,
stream
every way. I am a big fan, Jeffrey. I'm a big
Thank
fan.
You.
Also, so privileged to be your friend. So,
yes. I appreciate it. You know, you guys are a lot of fun to talk to, and I've known Jim forever, even though we're not, you know, I don't talk to you every day. And it's, you know, I feel like that if we did talk every day, we'd never get off the phone though. I mean,
that's true.
<You're> every day. Yes. So Scott Hathaway says Jeff could play sticks blindfolded and half asleep.
That's true.
Yeah. I feel like that might be the truth.
I don't know. I kind of feel like that right now.
Thank you so much for being with us tonight. We are so privileged
we really appreciate you being
to have you
us,
on.
Man.
And we just
thank
love
you.
You
no,
so
I'm.
Much.
I'm. Thank you for asking me. I appreciate it.
Oh, absolutely, man. Absolutely. Are you kidding? That was very. It was fascinating to
super
see your
fun. Super fun.
We had a blast at your birthday party too.
Oh man, thank you so much for being a part of it, man. That was
you guys killed it.
Oh, it was incredible.
You guys were everything I knew
you
would be.
And I got to play with them. Are you kidding?
You were everything I knew you would bring to the party. So you
played with this many times.
Thank you, man. Appreciate that.
And you're always welcome, of course.
Oh man, I'm telling you, you're my favorite band to watch live. If you guys
kidding?
Are playing and we're not, then I'm gonna be there. So
thank you.
Well, say hello to April for us. And,
oh, thank you. I will.
Yeah.
We'll see you at the next K-Tel show that we can make, and have a great night.
All right, Jeff. We love you so much.
If you go to K-Tel's webpage, all the dates should be there. So.
Yeah, okay. I'll put that all the links underneath this broadcast, so we have all the links to the K-Tel, your JeffBryanMusic.com. Mm-hmm. We'll do all the links below.
Okay, cool. All right, guys, have a great night.
Thank you.
Love you. So all right. It's the world.